time have come and gone since I first heard it told how that Jesus would come again someday.
My brothers and sisters, we want to get to the Word of God, and on this night we want to look at the subject history on trial. History on trial, that's our subject matter for tonight. That's our title for the sermon, history on trial. And I pray that God will speak to us on this night, and I pray that somebody here will recognize that they can trust the authority of the Word of God, believe what God has said, stand upon the promises of God, and leave from this place confident that God will lead, God will direct in your life. At the end of this message, I will make an appeal, and I will call for you to stand upon the promises of God and allow God's word to be filling in your life, and you will feel so strengthened by his power to walk after his way, walk after his path. Your heads are bowed, your eyes are closed. We're going to God in prayer at this time before we get to the word. Father God, we are grateful. We are thankful. You have been good to us. Throughout this day, many were the obstacles that many of us faced. Many are the challenges that came our way. There are some individuals here tonight, Heavenly Father, you know them because you know each situation. They came here tonight down in spirit, depressed. But you have brought them to this place to remind them that in you there is hope. You have brought them to this place tonight to remind them that there is joy for the journey. And so, God, even as we open your word one more time, I ask you, God, that you will just take charge of this moment. I surrender, I submit. I give myself to you and ask, oh God, that you will take over my mind. Take over my tongue. Speak so that your people will understand. Speak so that they will respond. Ultimately, Heavenly Father, it is our desire to walk with you all the way, to follow you every step. Oh God, I pray that you will do for someone tonight what they never thought possible, and that is you will transform their lives completely. Oh God, I thank you for hearing our prayers, because we pray in Jesus' name. Let everybody say amen. Amen. History on trial. Brothers and sisters, I have come across many individuals who have said to me, they have told me, that they cannot trust the Bible. Many of you have met with individuals from time to time who have declared that the Bible is written by man. And as a result, they cannot trust what is in the Bible. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to declare to you one of the reasons that I trust the Bible is because I have proven time and time again that what is in the Word of God, what is in the Bible, stands the test of time. I have tried it, and I've proven it, and it has worked wonders in my life. And I've been telling you since Sabbath, and I tell you once again tonight, that I do not preach unless I am convicted and convinced about what I'm saying. I know for myself that when I open the Word of God, based on what it has done for me, I can recommend it to you. Do I have a witness? Now tonight, I want to share with you one instance in Scripture that solidifies, it opens the mind to the reality that the Bible stands strong. And if we can trust history, the Bible is really not on trial, but history is on trial. Come with me in the Bible, if you have them with you, if you have them on your device. Come with me, and we're going to be going to a book in the Bible called Daniel. I want to show to you from this chapter, Daniel chapter 2. I want to show to you that the Bible says some things. And when the Bible says it, history, when you put history on trial, history says the word of God is true. Now, if that's clear for us tonight, that the Bible says it and history confirms it, then you and I can go out of here and declare authoritatively that what God's word says, we can stand upon it. Can I hear you say amen? Now, there's a story in the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 2. It tells of a king. Now, the book of Daniel, it bears the name of the prophet Daniel, God's man, taken from his homeland into a place called Babylon. And Daniel was there. And the Bible tells us that while Daniel and his friends, we will talk about his friends some other time, their name, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, while they were there in Babylon, they had several experiences of tests in their lives. The Bible tells us in Daniel chapter 1, no sooner than they got into Babylon, taken away from their homeland, the Bible tells us that they were tested in accordance with how they should live in terms of what they should eat. The Bible tells us that God blessed them because they decided that they were not going to eat from the king's table. They were not going to put anything in their bodies that was not good for them. They were going to trust God, and the Bible tells us that because they trusted God, God came through for them. And I want to tell you tonight that anytime you put God to the test, anytime you decide to stand up for God, anytime you decide that you're going to trust God rather than man, you can count on it, God will come through for you. And God came through for them. The king decided, because these men have shown that there is power, and in fact a higher power than the king of the earth, I'm gonna make them into wise men in my kingdom. Well, that was Daniel chapter 1. Now, Daniel chapter 2, the king, Nebuchadnezzar is his name. The Bible tells us in the second year of his reign, he went to bed. And the Bible tells us that he dreamed dreams. Now, I don't know how many of you dream dreams. And there are times in my life I've had a whole lot of dreams. And when I wake up, I want to forget them. Do I have a witness? Anybody here? I keep remembering some of those dreams that I've dreamed. I dream some things sometimes I wonder. A few weeks ago, I dreamt that I was in a physics class. Physics. Now, I'm a preacher. I'm not a scientist. I was in a physics class. I was dreaming. It's a dream. And I dreamt that while I was in the class, the professor asked me a question. Now, brothers and sisters, in my dream, I remember that in my dream, while I was dreaming it, the question was very clear. And I was a brilliant physics student in my dream. I could answer the question in my dream. I remember vividly that the professor used a whole lot of big terms in my dream. Next morning, I woke up and I got up and I said, I'm a scientist. But I could not remember what I dreamt the night before. I've had those instances, and I've had instances of dreams where I really wanted to forget about the thing that I dreamt. Nebuchadnezzar went to his bed one night, and the Bible tells us that he dreamt something very important. He dreamt something was going on. The Bible tells us the next morning when he woke up, he knew that the dream was important, but he could not remember the dream. The Bible tells us he called throughout his kingdom all the wise men. He had a whole lot of wise men on staff, paid wise men. He invited them to come in. When they came in, the Bible tells us that Nebuchadnezzar said to them, "Hey, last night while I slept, I dreamt something. I can't recall what I dreamt. But because I pay you, I want for you to tell me what I dreamt. And I want to know what all of this means." Well, his wise men were wise enough to say to him, "King, hey, tell us the dream. We will do what we can to interpret the dream." The king said, "Listen to me. You are on my staff. I pay you big bucks. You've got to tell me my dream and tell me what it means, or else you're going to be dead. I'm going to kill you." They said to him once again, "King, listen, King. If you tell us the dream, we guarantee you we will be able to tell you about it." King said, "You all are buying time. You're wasting my time in here. I'm going to send out a strict order that all the wise men in this territory, Babylon, should be killed." Now, my brothers and my sisters, the order was great. The king had the chief of his bodyguards, Arioch, called him, "Go, get rid of all the wise men." Now, Daniel and his friends, they were classed among the wise men. And so this decree, execute them, kill them, get rid of them, it was a strong command. Arioch went out to find Daniel. And when he came to the place where Daniel was, he met upon Daniel. And my brothers and my sisters, I want to declare unto you that as a child of God, you can walk in confidence knowing that you serve a God who sits on the throne. The Bible tells us that when Arioch came, he came into Daniel. Daniel said, "Hey man, take a chill pill. Hold on. Why is this decree so hasty? Why are you all in a hurry?" Arioch explained to him what was going on. Nobody could answer what the king wanted because the king dreamt something and the king could not remember it, and the king got upset. And Daniel said, "Listen to me. It is true that no wise man on earth can tell the king what the king wants to hear. There is nobody who is wise enough on earth to know what the king dreamt and be able to interpret it." But you know, anytime Daniel starts like that, Daniel is coming with something else. Because anytime there is an impossibility in our lives, we don't have to stop with the impossibility. Daniel says, "No man can be wise enough to do it. But I declare unto you, the king needs to hear from me. I want to go in and see him and tell him that there is power in the God I serve." Daniel went in to see the king, and the king met him. Now, my brothers and sisters, as a child of God, I can declare unto you that you can walk with confidence. Are you listening to me? You can walk with confidence knowing I have met individuals who want to make a decision for Jesus Christ. I've preached all over the place and I've met individuals. They have a challenge working on their job, and they are telling if they make a decision for Christ, they're going to get fired. And I've declared to them that the God who gave you the job will stand up for you. And I've seen them go and speak to the boss. And the boss said, listen to me. If you can do what you do and give up that day of Sabbath to go to church, and you can work as you have worked, I trust you enough, and I will make sure that nothing happens to you. I declare unto you, when you stand up for God, God will open doors for you. I have witnessed it. Daniel comes in. He wasn't afraid to stand before the king. And when you serve God, you're not afraid. When you serve the God I serve, you're not afraid to stand before kings, before princes. You're not afraid to tell the truth. You're not afraid because you know God will be with you. I testify all the time that I've been in some sticky situations. Sticky meaning some troublesome situations. And I have never been afraid to stand up for my conviction and speak the truth about God. I remember one night, I'm coming back to Daniel. I remember one night I was under a tent in Jamaica preaching in a crusade. And brothers and sisters, sometimes when you preach, it gets so sweet that you say some things and it cuts very hard. Are you listening to me? And I was there under the tent, and I remember I was in a community where the young men, they would sit on the sidelines and they would roll their marijuana in their paper. They would smoke it. You could smell it under the tent. And every time one of the church sisters or a lady would pass by, they would be making all kinds of sounds, trying to call them over. And brothers and sisters, I stood up in the pulpit one night and I was saying, ladies, when you walk through this community and the young men, they're listening to me, they're right outside the tent. I said, when those young men, they see you walking by and they try to call you by making sounds out of their mouths, you need to turn to them. And in the words of Bob Marley, this is what I said, I'm preaching. I said, in the words of Bob Marley, you gotta chase those crazy bald heads out of town. Listen, those men got mad, but I didn't stop there. I said to the young ladies listening to me, I said, there are some men, they would want to treat you like old MacDonald had a farm. You know, I was feeling the spirit. I was saying, here a touch, there a touch, everywhere a touch, touch. I was feeling it. I said, you tell them you're a child of God. You serve God and you are very important. And I'm saying to you tonight, you are children of God. Well, the young men were mad with me. And I didn't know. I was just preaching the word. Listen, that night, my dad was at the meeting. And I tell you something about my dad. My dad is my greatest supporter. And when he was there, he was standing and he was shouting. And when he was shouting, I felt good. My dad is shouting and I'm preaching. And listen, that night I had to take my dad home. And in taking him home, I did not go the route that I normally would go when I was driving home. I took my dad home and I drove a different direction. The next day I came under the tent. And as I was sitting there, I came early, as I normally would do. I like to be early. And so I came. I sat under the tent. One of the young men from the community, I didn't know what was going on. He came and he said to me, Pastor, you move with the Spirit. I said, what do you mean? He said, you move with the Spirit. I heard you preaching last night. I said, oh, praise God. He said, no. It wasn't about what you said. I didn't like what you said in your sermon. And he said to me, there were 10 of us. When we heard you last night, we went on the road where we know you drive. and we had a pile of stones. We had our machetes waiting for you. And they said, we waited, and we waited, and we waited, and you did not come. And we came up to the tent, and you were not there. And they said, it must be that God is working with you. I said, I went a different direction because my dad was here and God led me a different direction. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. When you stand up for God, God will stand up for you. He will protect you. He will keep you. I declare here tonight, God is my refuge. You're not afraid to stand before kings. Daniel stood before the king and said, Brother King, give me some time. Because none of the wise men can tell you, but there is a God in heaven. He knows everything, and I need to consult with him. Your command is too hasty. Hold a while, O king. I want to make it known to you, but I need to consult with headquarters. And I declare unto you, my brothers and sisters, there is power in consulting with headquarters. There is power in praying to God. I declare unto you, if you got a problem, if you got a challenge, you don't have to worry. Dial Jesus. Oh, you don't understand what I'm saying. I used to have those phones, not these mobile phones now, where you got to just press something. I remember those phones where you had to... Are you with me, somebody?
Yes, sir.
Your entire body had to shift with that. I remember those phones. Good old songwriter says, call him up and tell him what you want. I lived in a community back in Jamaica when I was growing up. I told you I didn't even have electricity, let alone having phones. Had to walk for miles to go to a call box. The only one miles around. When you got there, several people standing in line. You had to wait. And there were times when I wanted to call somebody overseas, United States or someplace in the Caribbean. And I didn't have money. As a kid, didn't have money, but you want to make a call. And so there was something known as you could dial the operator. The operator would tell the person, there's a collect call. You know about collect call, don't you? The operator would say, is this a collect call? I said, yes, it is a collect call. But the only thing for a collect call to work is for the person on the other end to cooperate. And there were times when I stood in that line 2 hours waiting to make the call. And when the operator came on and I said, collect call, and they would go off for a while and then they would come back and the person would decline the call. After 2 hours of waiting. Well, I'm here to let you know that when you dial J-E-S-U-S, when you dial heaven, God will not decline your call. Amen. Daniel said, I've got to talk with headquarters. That night, Daniel gathered his friends and they prayed together. Let me tell you something about friends. You got to have some friends who will pray with you. You got to have some friends who will motivate and lift you. You got to have some friends when troublesome times come. You will have them to lean upon. Can I hear you say amen? Daniel said, I got some friends. I want to talk with them. We're going to pray. And the Bible tells us they prayed. And God heard the prayers. The Bible tells us that God revealed the dream and the interpretation to Daniel that night. That's the God I serve. He will come through. Next morning, Daniel woke up, and trust me, if I were Daniel, the first thing I would do at break of day, God revealed the dream, an urgent decree to kill all wise men. The first thing I would do would be to run to the king and tell him. But the Bible said Daniel paused for a while and gave thanks to God. Because when God blesses you, you ought to spend a moment to tell him thanks. And maybe that's why when I come to church, when I come in the house of God, my brothers and my sisters, I get so excited because it's an opportunity for me to lift my hands in praise, lift my voice in praise, lift my body in praise. So sometimes you may see me acting a fool, but it's simply because God has been good to me. Are you listening to me, somebody? And I declare I cannot give 50% praise. I cannot give 50% energy when I preach. Somebody asked me, Pastor, how you preach the same way with 5, 10, 15, 20, and 100? And let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. I've learned a long time ago that I don't preach to numbers. I preach because God is good. And I need to tell somebody about the goodness of God. Are you listening to me? I've learned my lesson. Years ago, I was pastoring. Young lady came to me and said, Pastor, I want for you to bury my grandmom. And I said, sure. She said, Pastor, you don't know my grandmom, but I said, that's not a problem. I certainly am happy to do it. I said, when will the service be, and do you want me to get the church ready? She said, No, Pastor. No. No, don't have to worry about the church. No. We're going to have it at the funeral chapel. Now, the moment she said that to me, I'm being transparent with you tonight. The moment she said funeral chapel, in my mind, the service is going to be a small service, not too many people. And so I decided then, I was a young pastor at the time, I decided then that, you know, you don't really have to prepare. You can just go and wing it. Say whatever comes to your mind. Many years ago. And brothers and said, yeah, many years ago, I learned my lesson. And I remember the day of the funeral service. When I went, I showed up to the funeral chapel. I drove in and I saw somebody, an attendant at the gate, and he had a clipboard in his hand. And I said to him, I'm here for such and such. Her funeral. And he said, not a problem. That's the only funeral we have here today. But I looked at the chapel parking lot. And I saw some vehicles there in the parking lot. And the vehicles, I knew they were vehicles that only government representatives would drive. And brothers and sisters, here I am unprepared. Wow. And I said to God, God, if you deliver me this last time, I'll never make it happen again. Are you with me, somebody? And guess what? I went in, God delivered me, and I made a decision that anytime I stand to preach before individuals, if it's one or 1,000, I'm going to preach the same way because God deserves my best. That's why night after night when I come here and I testify and I tell you that I preach with a conviction because I believe what I'm saying, I'm not telling you something that I don't believe in. Daniel said, God, I thank you. You are the one who revealed the dream. Now I can go in boldness. Now I can tell the king what he dreamt. And what it means, the Bible tells us that Daniel spoke to the king. Daniel said, King, it is true. What you said is correct. Your people can't tell the dream. They can't tell anything about it. But I serve a God, and he revealed to me what you dreamt in your night vision. And pause for a moment, brothers and sisters, before I go further. God gave to a king, Nebuchadnezzar, who was a bad man a dream that his servant needed to interpret. Now listen to what Daniel said to him. King, you went to bed and you dreamt that you saw a multi-metallic man standing out in a plain. He had a head of gold. He had chest and arms of silver. He had belly and thigh of brass. He had feet of iron. And king, you saw his toes too, and they were a mix of iron and clay. But king, you didn't stop in the dream. You saw until a stone came, cut out without hands, and that stone came and smote the image, crushed it. That stone filled the entire earth. King said, my goodness, now I remember, that's exactly what I dreamt. God revealed to Daniel the king's dream. God revealed to Daniel the interpretation of the dream. Daniel said to him, King, let me tell you what this thing means. The Bible tells us, Daniel said to him in Daniel chapter 2 and verse 36, this is the dream. Now we will tell the interpretation of it before the king. Daniel said to him, King, the head of gold that you saw, let me tell you what it represents. Daniel told him in Daniel chapter 2, 37 and 38. Daniel said to him, you, your kingdom, you are the head of gold. And then Daniel said to him, after your kingdom, another will arise. And another will arise. And another will arise. Now, brothers and sisters, it's important for us to understand tonight, number one, that God gave to a heathen king a message of hope, of salvation, of authority, of authenticity, of his word that we can stand upon. You didn't hear me. I said a heathen king. God had several people he could have chosen. But God chose a heathen king. And you know what that tells me? That God does not work arbitrarily. It tells me that God moves in mysterious ways. God moves in ways that we cannot understand. God moves in ways in your lives that only God can explain to you why he does what he does. And that's why I will tell people who are here, many of you who have never thought of worshiping in a setting like this. Many of you, you did not believe by any stretch of your imagination you would be sitting in a church on a night like this. But God has worked it out so that you could be here. So the synchronism of your queries and God's working in your life and God providing somebody to declare his word will come together, because God moves in mysterious ways. Nothing happens by chance or happenstance. God wants you here for a reason. God used Nebuchadnezzar. God said to him, you are the head of gold. And brothers and sisters, Babylon was his kingdom. The kingdom of Babylon that Nebuchadnezzar reigned in. It didn't last forever. History confirms to us, brothers and sisters, that after the kingdom of Nebuchadnezzar, just as Daniel told the king in verse 39 of Daniel chapter 2, Daniel said to him, after your kingdom shall arise another kingdom inferior to your kingdom. Notice his kingdom was a kingdom of gold. Daniel said the other kingdom would be a kingdom of silver. History confirms, brothers and sisters, that after the kingdom of Nebuchadnezzar, after the kingdom of Babylon, there arose another kingdom, the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians. History is on trial. God said, Nebuchadnezzar, your kingdom will not last forever. God said this ahead of time. Here comes history marching in on the stand. History, do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So help you God. History responds, yes. History, after the kingdom of Babylon, did another kingdom arise? Yes. Babylon reigned for a while. But one night, on the 13th of October, 539 BC, a man named Cyrus led his military might into Babylon through a gate that was left open. Some say by accident, but I say the hand of God was fulfilling his word so that history would confirm that the word of God is true. The Bible tells us that on that night, that same night, years after Nebuchadnezzar, years after, the Bible tells us that Babylon was destroyed. In fact, it was overcome by the kingdom of the Medes and Persian. But Daniel did not stop there. The Bible tells us that Daniel said to the king, O king, let me tell you something. That would not be the end of the story, because you had the dream go on. Another kingdom came. Daniel said to him, hey, king, we've got to put this out there so that history will confirm that the word of God is true. After that second kingdom, a third kingdom shall come. And brothers and sisters, after the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians, yes, another kingdom came, the kingdom of Greece. History, you are still on trial. Do you still swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? After the kingdom of the Medes and the Persians, did another kingdom really arise? Well, history confirms, my brothers and sisters, that that is certainly true, because the Medes and the Persians, they reigned from 539 BC to 331, when yet another kingdom came to ascendancy, when someone by the name of Alexander the Great overran the territory. And my brothers and sisters, the kingdom of Greece took over. History confirms that the word of God is true. History declares that what God says will come to pass. Surely will come to pass. But Daniel didn't stop there. Daniel said to him, after that kingdom, still another kingdom shall arise. History, you are still on trial. Will you confirm what Daniel said many years ago? Is it true? History, do you still swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? History confirms that the kingdom of Greece was conquered by the kingdom of Rome. History declares it. History confirms it. That what God said in his word would come to pass. The kingdom of Greece reigned from 331 BC to 168 BC. That's history. But God had said it. God had shown it to Nebuchadnezzar. God revealed it to Daniel. And history confirms it. History is on trial, and it confirms that the word of God is true. But King, you saw not just feet of iron. You even saw the toes, iron and clay. History, come once again. You're on trial. Did Rome reign forever? No, history tells us again that the monarchy of Rome reigned from 168 BC to around about 476 AD. And history tells us, brothers and sisters, that the kingdom of Rome, history confirms it, that the kingdom of Rome was divided into 10 kingdoms. History is on trial. And history confirms that the word of God is true. Now, my brothers and my sisters, I want for you to understand that you can go home tonight. You can go on your computers. You can go searching the history of what I just declared, because the Bible made it clear that the feet of iron and clay would represent a broken Roman monarchy. And brothers and sisters, history will tell us that the 10 kingdoms, the Ostrogoths representing Italy, Visigoths, Spain, and southern France, the Franks, northern France, the Vandals, North Africa, the Burgundians, Switzerland, the Lombards, the Suevites, the Anglo-Saxons, the Alemanni, the Herulites, they were the 10 tribes that came out of Rome. History confirms that the word of God is true. But the king saw something else. The king saw in his dream, brothers and sisters, that it did not end there. The king saw a stone cut out without hands. The king saw that stone coming, and it smote the image, crushed it to pieces, filled the entire earth. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to declare unto you that where we are in history is represented by the toes. We are still in the toes. We are probably in the toenails. Because the next thing the king saw and Daniel interpreted was a stone cut out without hands. And number one thing of priority for all of us here tonight is that if that was the last thing of the dream, then it means that we need to make our lives in accordance with God's will. Because anytime now, that stone will be cut out without hands. And Daniel made it clear, brothers and sisters, and you and I ought to know that that is the kingdom of God. That is God's kingdom. Because you and I must recognize that men all over this world may try to do all kinds of things to reign supreme, but God's kingdom reigns forever. Now watch this. The feet were of iron and of clay. And this also symbolizes, because iron and clay cannot come together. They cannot cleave together. And Daniel said to the king, hey, that's a representation of a broken system. Now when Rome was divided into 10, into these tribes, the 10 tribes, brothers and sisters, there are many individuals who have tried to bring them back together. They have tried to make all kinds of unions and unifications so that they would bring it into one kingdom. But God declared a long time ago that the 10 toes are iron and clay, and they will not cleave together. Throughout European history, when you spend some time to read it, there were several cases of intermarriage where they try to bring the kingdoms together. But the Bible had declared that they will mingle themselves with the seed of men. It's right there, Daniel chapter 2. In an effort to bring them together, they will mingle themselves with the seed of men. They had all kinds of intermarriages, all kinds of situations where they were bringing families together, trying to bring Europe together. There was the European Union that worked for a while until Brexit. History continues to confirm that the word of God is true. History is on trial, and history has one thing to tell us tonight. We need to trust the word of God. And my brothers and my sisters, when you read the annals of history, you will recognize how many individuals have tried to defy the word of God. But when God says something, God means it. God says they will not cleave together. The 10 toes will not cleave together. The feet, it will not come back together. That's why, brothers and sisters, we will never see a united kingdom in this world until Jesus Christ comes. I can stand here because I trust the word of God and declare unto you that you will not see it, because God's word is true. Many men have tried it. Charlemagne tried it, but he was defeated. Charles V tried it, but he was defeated. Louis XIV tried it, and he was defeated. Napoleon tried it, and he was defeated. Kaiser Wilhelm tried it, and he was defeated. Hitler tried it, and he was defeated. They were defeated because, brothers and sisters, God said they shall not cleave together. And when God says something, God means what he says. And we can stand upon his word. We can trust the Bible. I tell you tonight, I have seen it. I trust it. I stand on it. The word of God is true. That's why when God said to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden that I will send my son to die for you, I'll put enmity between you and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. We spoke about that last night. God's word always comes to pass. He made the promise in the Garden of Eden. He kept the promise. Jesus Christ came to the earth. He made his promise. Jesus died on a cross, shedding his blood so that we may have life and have it abundantly. God gives his word and we can stand upon it. And that's why tonight, for somebody who is here listening to me, when God says to you, if you step out and you follow me, I will stand with you. You give me your heart and I will give you my eternal kingdom. God says, if you walk with me, I'll walk with you. If you give me your hand, I'll lead you. You can trust him. He says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all things shall be added unto you. You can trust him. You can take him at his word. He will transform your life. He will make you new. He will give you a fresh start. People will see a difference in you. Last thing I'll tell you before I go tonight, before I make that call. When I graduated from college, one of my friends, he met me one day and he said, "Keith, let us come together, let us rent a house together, let's live." We rented a 2-bedroom flat. We lived there for a while. Now I tell you, brothers and sisters, that friend of mine, his name Alan Jones, that boy was a preacher. Every day I would watch him study. And I would see him get some stuff out of the Bible. And I would say to him, "How did you see that?" He would show me. Brilliant preacher. I remember Alan decided that he was going to get married, and I saw him one afternoon. I was driving out of an occasion and he was driving in. We stopped our cars. I said to him, "Man, are you ready for the wedding?" He said, "Yes." He said, "It's 9 days from now." 9 days, 9 days. He said, "Do you have your suit ready?" I said, "Sure, I got my suit." We spoke for a while and then I said to him, "I'll see you later." That was the last thing I said. "I'll see you later." That night, I got a call that Alan just died. My good friend, great preacher, just died. Listen, I was stunned, I was shocked, I was upset, I was everything. The worst thing about it was that Alan was the only person in his family who was a member of the church that I'm a part of, the Seventh-day Adventist Church. He was the only one. I'm telling you tonight that for 6 months, as a preacher, for 6 months, I put the word aside. I said, "I can't trust the word." As a preacher, I put it aside. I could not preach for 6 months. I did not trust God for 6 months. "Why did you take my friend? Why?" I was angry. I said to God, I remember saying to God, "Of all the people in the world, why did you take him? There are so many bad people. Why did you take this good one?" I said, "God, if you would ask me, I could give you a list of people you could take out." And God said to me, "Keith, if I took your list, then I'll have to take everybody else's list, and maybe you would be on somebody's list." I said, "God, you keep your list. You do what you do, because what you do best." I did not understand it. Couldn't understand it. I remember Alan's family came to me. Alan, know my time is gone. I'm going to send you home in a minute. Alan's family came to me and they said, because Alan had large library, and they said, Keith, we want for you to get all his books. We want for you to get it. And I said to them, I can't. I just can't handle opening the books because I'm going to remember him. I just can't. You could donate them to the university, or better yet, I said to them, he would want for you to read it. Just read the books. Remember, nobody from his family were in the church. That was 1998. 2002, I went to preach in England, London, England. And I'm there preaching one night. And as I'm preaching and I'm getting excited, as you see, I get excited sometimes. I saw this man, he stepped out in the aisles. It was a little dark in the church, so I couldn't make him out. But he looked like Alan. And he was shouting, hallelujah! And I'm preaching and I'm looking. I'm saying, no, it can't be. It could never be. Nobody from his family. When the service was over and I'm walking out, he jumped up, he grabbed me, and he said, Keith, it's me. And I looked at him, and I said, Richard, it is you? He said, yes. Now the entire church, they're looking at us because we're embracing, we're hugging, and we're talking. And I said, what are you doing here? He said, Keith, I read the book. I read the book. And now I am baptized, and not just me, but my family. You're not getting what I'm trying to tell you. I couldn't understand it when Alan died, but they got the book. They read the book. Tonight, as I stand here preaching the word, tonight, right here, as I am preaching the word, Richard, he is an elder in the Meadowvale Seventh-day Adventist Church in Jamaica, serving as first elder for the church. Why? Because there's power in the word of God. I have seen it transform lives. I know what it can do. And I tell you tonight, if you step out and trust in God, God will do mighty things for you. And so tonight, all I'm declaring to you is, if you decide that I'm going to give Jesus my heart, I'm going to surrender to his word, he will make a difference in your life. I'm going to invite everybody to stand right now, because Gail is going to sing, I've decided to follow Jesus. And somebody out there, you are going to be coming, you're going to be coming forward, because we're going to pray for you tonight. I want for you to come. Come boldly. Step forward. Give Jesus your heart. Trust his word. It may not be clear in your life right now, but trust him. He will work it out. History has confirmed that you can trust the word of God.
I have decided
to follow Jesus.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus.
Will be the first to come forward tonight. Come.
Oh, take come. This old world, come. But give me Jesus. Come. Oh,
step for Jesus.
But give me Jesus.
He will give you the power.
No
turning to live the life
back. Step tonight. Speaking to you, come tonight. Just make that step. I have decided.
Make that step with Jesus.
I have decided.
I have decided
to follow Jesus.
I have decided.
To follow Jesus.
No turning back.
No turning back.
Praise the Lord.
No turning back.
Let me ask this question. Are you here tonight? You have decided to follow Jesus? Raise your hand. You have decided to follow Jesus. Everywhere in this place, you have decided to follow Jesus. Keep those hands up. Keep them up. I have decided to follow Jesus. Keep those hands up. Let me ask another question. Are you a baptized member of the believing body of Christ? If you are a baptized member of the believing body of Christ, you're a member of the church, take your hand down. If your hand is still up in the air, it means that you should be walking down the aisles. If your hand is in the air, walk down the aisles. Come, we're going to pray with you. Not yet baptized. Come on. Come on, come on. Don't be afraid. Don't be bashful. Don't be shy. Don't be nervous. Come. Let's come. Let's come. Let's come. Just come. No turning back. Come. We're going to pray for you tonight. We're going to pray for you. Come. Ain't no shame in your game. We're going to pray. Amen. Yeah, we're going to pray. Come.
I have decided.
Come on, everybody, sing.
To follow Jesus. I have decided.
To follow Jesus.
To follow Jesus.
I have decided. I want to sing one more time the cross before me, the world behind me.
The cross before me.
Yes, yes, yes.
The world behind me.
The world behind me, the cross before me.
The cross before me.
The world.
The world.
Before.
The cross before me.
No turning back.
No turning back.
Praise the Lord. No turning back.
No turning back.
Every head bowed, every eye closed, wherever you are in this place, we're going to talk to God at this time. Father God, what a privilege we have to be in your house tonight. You protected us through the day. You gave us this opportunity of worship. You opened up your word to us tonight to reveal to us that you are so interested in the salvation of humanity. Number one, that you would use even a heathen king, giving him a historical outlay of the events of our world. You showed it to him. You revealed the dream, the interpretation through your servant. It's very clear before us. History confirms that the Bible is true. We can trust your word. When we look, when we read the pages of history, they confidently declare that God's words stand true. Tonight, we can stand upon the word of God. We can stand upon the promises of God. If God said it, it means that God means it. If God says that he will stand up for us, he will stand up for us. No weapons formed against us will succeed. God will give his angels charge over us. God will wash our sins away. We can trust the word of God. And so for every person here tonight under the hearing of my voice who needs to understand, needs to know, I pray God that you will beat back the forces of the devil and remind them that they can trust you. Cleanse them tonight. Remind them, oh God, that the way they came in doesn't have to be the way they go out. That right now in this place, they can give their hearts to you. Right now, their sins are washed away. Give them the assurance that this very moment as they stand for you, that the blood of Jesus shed on Calvary is washing their sins away. Now, as they go from here, we know the devil doesn't like it. So we ask that you will post angels around them that excel with might and power, so that the enemy will not have his way with them. But, oh God, I pray that you will continue to convict them so they will stand for you. Oh God, I am confident there are others in this place in the hearing of my voice who needed to be at the altar tonight. But I pray, God, that you will stand with them, nurture them, speak a word of love, understanding to them, so that they will know, oh God, that you are entrusted in their full salvation. There are many of us, oh God, we have already given our lives to you, but tonight again, we have been reminded that we can stand upon your promises. And we thank you, God, for solidifying our faith in your word. And we ask, God, that even as we go from here tonight, as we lay our heads on our beds, that you will be there and that you will give us a good night's rest. Bring us back tomorrow night, when once again we shall feast at your table, study your word, and we shall fellowship and sing together. And because we know that you are hearing, knowing that you're answering our prayers, we tell you thanks, because we pray in the mighty, the matchless, the powerful name of Jesus. Let everybody who loves the Lord shout amen.
Amen.
Shout amen if you really mean it.
What a joy it has been to share with you in this Journey to Joy series. We would like to hear from you. Would you like us to pray for you? Oh, there's a number that comes on your screen. You can call that number right now, and it will be our joy just to pray with you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for tuning in. Continue as we journey together on our journey to joy.